Night flight has always been a rite of passage, a trip of entertainment discovery, old and new, an eye-opening taste of counterculture smoked with timeless jewels of artistic buds. Now, we can finally get closer to that original cable TV experience we've all been missing with Night Flight Plus, an all-access membership to original episodes of Night Flight, as well as a library of hundreds of music documentaries, concert movies, sci-fi and horror cult films, public access rarities, and more weird stuff. Right now, Wastoids listeners can get $10 off an annual membership. That means access to Night Flight's library for only $29.99 a year. Head to www.nightflightplus.com/promo code and enter Wastoids in all caps. That's W-A-S-T-O-I-D-S in all caps. Enter promo code Wastoids at nightflightplus.com/promo code and get back in the days.
Hey,
hello, hello. Check.
Hello, check 1, 2.
I think we're doing okay.
What's this new mark clip thing? That's cool. You can like leave little notes for yourself.
I totally could.
See that down there?
I think the only thing that would... Well, I just created a clip. So the first 19 seconds of us saying, yo, hey, what's up? That'll be riveting listening for somebody.
Nice.
So we have a guest, our second guest.
We've got a special guest for this episode of Click Vortex. We're hanging out talking about David Lynch, Twin Peaks specifically. And of course, that meant we had to get Duwaun from the Country Brothers podcast to come.
Hey. I love country music and David Lynch pretty.
I've been dying to talk.
About equal, so.
I think if you've seen Wild at Heart, that feels pretty.
Or even
feels pretty country.
This jacket is
a
symbol
way.
Of my individual.
Or even like Orville Peck. It's like he came straight out of a David Lynch movie. So it all works out, you know.
Influenced by,
so
for sure.
So for this episode, what we thought we were gonna what we'd do is for those who are new to the show, maybe we've got some new listeners. That would be cool. You know, it'd be great if
I've been telling all my friends, all four of them.
Thank you.
We decided that for this episode, each episode, Sam and I pick an internet tangent, and we just sort of wander around the rabbit holes of hyperlinks that we find. This one, we're talking specifically about Twin Peaks, as something that I can confidently say that all three of us are major Twin Peaks fans, major Lynch fans in general, certainly major Twin Peaks fans. Was it, before we get into our clicks, was it your guys' first David Lynch sort of thing?
So my
was Twin Peaks how you got introduced to him?
So me and Woodbury used to work at Zia Records together, and around that time, it was probably about 2010-ish, everybody kept being like, hey, you should check out Twin Peaks. I would try and check out Twin Peaks, and after the third episode, I'm like, why are they talking like this? This is weird. I thought it was going to be 22 episodes of like The Red Room. So I was like, I'm ready for this. And then it's like just Andy and his antics and just people talking about apple pie and or cherry pie rather, and you know, stuff like damn fine coffee. Like I want to see the little dude dancing for 6 episodes, but I didn't get that. And then years later, I was like, you know what, I'm gonna give this an honest chance. And like the 4th episode, I was hooked. And then I start going down a David Lynch rabbit hole, and man, turn me into the cool, weird individual I am today.
Was it your intro to Lynch, or did you see something else first?
I mean, I knew. Yeah, I had seen, like, Lost Highway. You know, I feel like that was a pretty... Which, coincidentally, I'm going to go see the 4K version of that tonight.
Jealous as hell.
But, yeah, I had seen Lost Highway. I you know, I think that was... I don't remember exactly when that came out, but... you know, at the time, I had a friend who was like super into Nine Inch Nails, and so that was, I think, where that introduction came from. We were just we went and saw the movie because he was just a fan of the soundtrack, and I always really liked what's her face, Arquette. So I just I mean, I think that was it. And then I didn't get into Twin Peaks until like 2008, probably 2007, 2008. I guess probably around the same time Duwaun was getting into Twin Peaks, I was too. I got introduced to it by a dude in my band, and we like totally just like bonded over it and freaked out about it. And I've been hooked ever since. So yeah, then I went back and obviously watched all the movies with a completely different mindset, like knowing that, you know, there's potential things related in the whole universe and of the weirdness.
I do agree with that about the idea of like watching Twin Peaks first and then going back and like watching like a Blue Velvet, for example, or even Mulholland Drive that obviously came out like years later, but you're like, man,
yeah,
not only do you see the similarities, but juxtapose those two movies together, you're still like, yep, that's Lynchian, even though like obviously he directed them, but like he can do yeah, like the dream thing, he can do the like just stay grounded but make it super weird, and not a lot of cats can do that.
Yeah, absolutely. I think Dune was my first. I saw Dune when I was in eighth grade.
Of course yours is Dune.
And it was
I think you're the only person yeah, you're the only person on earth who
and I loved it Dune so much. I was like, I gotta check out this other dude's movies because I bet they'll be really similar. And the truth is, of course, I bet they're all like this. Dune. And of course, the truth is they're not, but they are. There's more similarities than the surface like reveals. Like they are. Dune does fit into his discography. Everything from The Sleeper Must Awaken to some of the other weird sort of mythological stuff, but obviously Dune, not his favorite movie that he's ever made. But when I go back now and watch, cause yeah, I think Twin Peaks did come next, although maybe Blue Velvet first. I think I saw Blue Velvet, then went into Twin Peaks, and those feel, you know, kind of a piece. There's like a similar quality, yeah, not just cause Kyle MacLachlan's in both, but yeah. And then once I started Twin Peaks, I just got obsessed. And I think it's so funny, Duwaun, you were like, I want more of the lodges. I want more of the other worlds. Because then by the time season 3 comes out in 2017, then you get your wish. Like there's almost no cherry pie.
It's all Dougie Jones, baby.
It's all abstract horror and Dougie Jones, who, you know, Dougie's a controversial character. I'm a Dougie stan. I ride for Dougie, and I believe Duwaun's the same
way. I love Dougie Jones. Was it Halloween? I found a green jacket, and nobody knew why I had this oversized green jacket, and I was like, I'm Dougie Jones. And I couldn't act like Dougie Jones because I probably would have got kicked out of the bar, but it was just nice knowing, like, maybe somebody will know who I'm supposed to be, and of course nobody did, but I knew, and it made me feel good.
I would have known.
Yeah,
we get it.
I think the Dougie character is like the way, I mean, who could think that you could reinvent the wheel that is like the original Twin Peaks campiness, and it's like completely done through Dougie. I think that is like the to not like go back and replay the whole thing of the Twin Peaks, you know,
yeah,
town. They just they introduce this new character and this new like just weirdo sort of like wholesome, yeah, but then also twisted situation.
He's absolutely like a weird mirror. Like we'll get into this when we start getting into the clicks, but before we do that, I do want to say that the first time I went to Vegas after having watched Twin Peaks season 3, I did walk into a casino, and while walking to the casino floor, say, hello. Like I was
everybody's like, who the hell
you
is
can
this
get
guy?
Away with that is what I'm saying. You can't get away with Jade gives two rides, Dougie, or anything like that. Like you're not gonna, you know, you're in big trouble with Dougie if you're not careful. But yeah, I season 3 is sort of what I ended up. Sam, do you remember who started last week?
I think you're up. I think
I'm just gonna go for it then.
I mean, let's just say you. Yeah, I think I prefer
so. Duwaun,
you,
you've
actually
been kind of rewatching, right? You've been on a season 3. You watched a little chunk
every
of it.
On the Sunday, if I don't have anything to do, golf isn't as cool as it once was right now, and there's no good sports on, I'll just throw on a little bit of season 3. And I think I got through – I usually stop after the last two just because that last two episodes are pretty grim. And I like to see, like – I was, yeah, spoiler alert – when the guy with the green with the green hand beats up Bob.
Freddy.
The Hulk hand.
Freddy Jones.
And then, like, I usually kind of stop there.
Hell yeah.
And after the part where, like, they superimpose the face and that whole thing. And then I usually stop. So I think, like, last weekend, over the holiday weekend, I just watched it. So it's probably about my eighth rewatch.
That's fantastic. I don't know that I've rewatched it quite as much, but I have rewatched a lot of it, and I do go back to the well to drink deep and descend fairly often.
Before we get to
it, I wanted to start my.
For Sam and Woodbury, do you guys have like a favorite moment of the return?
That's so tough for me. But yeah, I mean, I think it's changed now, but on my original watch, I think that last scene that you're describing with the overlay where they all come into the office or whatever, and they're like everyone's standing there, and it's representing like it's very Wizard of Oz like, which there's a dude on Twitter, by the way, which is going in right now and like showing all the comparisons to Wizard of Oz and Twin Peaks, and it's actually pretty cool. Like you can see where a lot of this inspiration comes from. But yeah, that was like a very positive moment where you see I mean, is that where Diane,
she's just like when, set free, like, in that moment, I feel like, right?
Yeah, there's just a bunch of cool stuff happens there, and that's, I guess, that's when I guess Dale kind of snaps back into. I understand why that's
exactly
like a stopping point for you, because it's a very positive moment before things just get so.
Yeah, Freddie beating Bob up with the green hand is like the, you know, Wild at Heart, like the studio made Lynch cut like a happy ending, and so he went with the Wizard of Oz inspired ending at the end of Wild at Heart because they pushed him. I feel like in a weird funhouse mirror way, that's the happy ending of Twin Peaks The Return, but then it just keeps going. There's no good ending. It actually segues into the most horrifying thing that he's done yet on Twin Peaks in a weird way.
But that's when, I mean, I'm going to get into some of this a little bit later, but that's where like, this show just really wrecks your brain. We could probably talk about this for 200 years if we wanted to, because when you start digging into some of these theories and like why that is the happy ending and then why all those other things occur and how that is sort of splitting off into these parallel universes and stuff and like why you're actually seeing the overlay and like what is actually occurring in that moment. That's what makes it so hard, because there's just, in some of these things, when I was just making notes for this, I was just like, man, I can't even, there's so many things that just seem like it was just a creative, like just a simple, like creative idea, you know? But then when you start really digging into it and you see the layers of complexity around all of it, which, you know, some of that stuff, like some theories, like fan theories, they go pretty out, you know, some of them get pretty out there and like, I don't know, maybe they're questionable, but they do, a lot of them do connect, and you do wonder, like, man, where was this guy's head at when all this stuff was being made? And, like, how much of this is intentional and how much of it is just, like, a coincidence? You know, it's, like, it's weird. I mean, like, when you watch a movie like Inland Empire or something and you know how that played out, where there wasn't really, like, a traditional script. But then you can make all these connections, not only, like, within the movie itself, but within, the regular Twin Peaks universe. It does seem like a lot of it's intentional, even if they're, you know, more or less claiming it's not. So, but yeah, I would say my actual favorite
is
what I'm going to talk about.
All right.
Later. So at this point,
I will say that my favorite moment, I just am going to go with the gut, my gut instinct, like not overthink it. The absolute first thing that came to mind to me, shit, God damn it. Two things came to mind. All right. Okay. My gut is when the weird woodsman comes out of the spiral and kills Matthew Lillard in the back seat of the car, and he's in there with that other cop guy while Gordon Cole and Tammy and Diane are all, they're all investigating or whatever. And then they come back when the guy starts screaming, Matthew Lillard's head is like mostly eaten off or something weird. And Lynch looks in as Gordon Cole and goes, he's dead. To me, that's the part that, like, I laughed so, so hard every time. And it's not, Twin Peaks is obviously, there's like so many things. Episode 8 as a whole comes to mind. I'm thinking of the atomic bomb and we go into the blast. That's one of my favorite parts. the scene where the two brothers, Belushi and the other
Mitchum
guy,
brothers.
They witness the, like, when the Mitchum brothers see the guy that the other criminals had run into, Jennifer Jason Leigh, and do you remember who I'm talking about? Like, they rear end the guy,
oh,
and then he
yeah.
takes out a machine gun and just, like, destroys these bad guys who we've been watching the entire season. A character we've never seen before blows them all away. And Belushi says, like, what the fuck kind of town is this? And he's like, people under a lot of stress, Bradley. And, like, to me, that one always gets me, too. So for whatever reason, I keep being drawn to the sort of, like, more jokey parts. But even those, I think, point to the overall kind of weirdness. What about you, Duwaun? What's your favorite single moment?
It was when I saw, and it will always be that part where Big Ed thinks Norma did him dirty, and then you see that hand. Whew. I remember even texting Woodbury. I was like, my man, did you see that? Blew me away. I was just like, that is the most beautiful, tender thing I've ever seen from a David Lynch movie. And then right after that, he just gutted you again. But I felt, you know, like, you know what? I will always have this moment. It is beautiful.
When he drops that Otis,
man.
That Otis Redding song in, it's yeah.
When you see that hand,
no,
it's just,
he is such a sweetheart. He obviously is he has like a terrifying side to his imagination, but he's also so, so drawn to tenderness and sweetness. Like, The Straight Story is, everybody should watch The Straight Story. It's his weirdest film by virtue of its conventionality, but it is really good and it is really sweet, you know? So that's a side of him.
That's the one I haven't seen. It's the only one.
Well, get ready
yet.
To be blown away by how few interdimensional portals are in that one. Not a lot.
My cousin was just talking to me about another, whatever. Yeah. I don't remember. I'll talk to you about that on the side. Another like Lynch sort of sub thing that I'm curious to get your opinion on. But anyway, yeah. So I guess the primary focus is, you know, not just Twin Peaks, but we're talking
that's
like music.
Yeah. So for my click, I kind of focused a little bit on the music of the Roadhouse, specifically in season 3 as a starting point. To me, the Roadhouse is like maybe the key to, like, well, I don't know if it's the key to understanding Twin Peaks season 3. I don't know if you do have to understand season 3 in order to be moved by it, but the Roadhouse is a really interesting thing to me because, like the lodges, the black and the white lodge, it's like a weird liminal place where it's hard to tell what's real and what's in people's maybe dreams or imaginations in the Roadhouse. And it never really played that role in the original series. It was only with Fire Walk With Me that starts to kind of come into the picture. So I wanted to shout out the song Pink Room from the Fire Walk With Me soundtrack. It's like one of my favorite spooky Lynch Bad Lamente things. So the Roadhouse in season 3, it's really fascinating because you get all these different characters, a lot of whom we don't know, right? Just like people who are just sitting at tables being like, hey, Natalie told me this, or Abby and Clark had this going on. And it's like we're getting all these like little tidbits of people's lives. We have no idea where they're at in the broader context of things.
Yeah, I really love that. Like, as far as I remember, really none of that ever connects with anything.
There's
right? Like any of those, like, do any of those subplots connect with stuff outside?
I think
in
there
the world?
Are some a few moments where they're talking maybe about I think sometimes like Billy might be somebody who's referenced, but they're very tangentially related, if at all. Like, you don't get,
I mean, I guess there's the point where James and the whole can guy are in the Roadhouse, so that connects it. But yeah, I mean, just a lot of those, like, and there is the, like, who's the crazy cokehead dude that steals the truck and whatever. He's like,
Richard Horn, right? Guy, like, or not Richard.
Oh yeah. Yeah. The Richard Horn.
It's Aubrey's guy. It's Aubrey's son,
right?
Aubrey and evil Dale Cooper, Mr. C. It's a pretty gross thing that they don't get into like very explicitly, but I think we're to understand that was not a consensual situation. And so he does That's actually, so that's one of the scenes I wrote. I wrote, first off, I think most of the music in Twin Peaks season 3 that we see in the Roadhouse, I like most of it. I don't like all of it, but I do like most of the performances. And one of my favorites is when that band Trouble plays, which is, that's Sam Smith and Alex Jang Hung Tai from the band Dirty Beaches, who, I don't know if you've ever heard the Dirty Beaches album Badlands, either of you, but it's Lynchian, total Lynch. So he's in that, and then Riley Lynch, David Lynch's son, and Dean Hurley, who does like almost all of the sound design with Lynch. That's who makes up that band for that scene. And they play this absolutely menacing thing while the horn offspring is just like a terrifying creep and threatens a woman and all that stuff. But that tune is so good and so scary and menacing. It fits that scene so well. But I love that the Roadhouse is a place of terror like that, but it's also a place of like sublime beauty, you know? So you see when James Hurley does his tune, and he's always been cool, is what one of the girls says. Like, I think that's another really beautiful, tender moment in a way. I think the Cactus Blossoms performance is so good.
Yeah, that one's rad.
Obviously the Chromatics.
I think the Cactus Blossoms is, I think, one of my favorites. That was one where I actually went out and was like, I want to hear more of this band after
talk about the country Lynch crossover, Duwaun. You got a little of that right there.
It's all coming back. All coming back.
But so they do theirs. There's the Chromatics one is really good, Shadow. And I think that one legitimately ties to the themes of the show lyrically. I think Lynch is really weird when it comes to music. Musical lyrics. He writes a lot of lyrics for various collaborations. He's written stuff for the late Julie Cruz, you know, RIP, absolute queen genius right there. But I don't know. It's a weird situation with the Roadhouse because it's all these beautiful things happen there, all these terrible things happen there, and it's just serves as this weird centralized point for the show.
I like the groundingness of the Roadhouse, like the positioning of how it sort of reset everything, the like bringing it to real life with like kind of allowing these bands to be themselves, mm-hmm. you know, which
that's what's wild about it, right?
When you're in this who knows where you just were. It's interesting how that it's another thing I really appreciate about the return, because the expectations going into watching that, like, you didn't really know, like, you wanted to trust that it was going to be weird and new and different, but you know, with anytime something gets remade or brought back, there's always the risk of it just sucking, and like, clearly that's not what happened here, at least for the three of us. I think we acknowledge that you know, it's maybe even, I mean, I don't know how you guys feel, but it's I feel like it's better than the original, or it at the very least it solidifies ties everything together that you know, it ties the original, it ties all the movies, but then if we're talking like expanded universe, it brings all the movies together.
Thank you guys, so
it really is this thing that everything else makes sense now after watching that. Especially when you go back and watch the other movies and stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. Duwaun, does that resonate for you?
I didn't hear what he said because you guys froze. But I think I got the I think I got the gist of it.
But now you
what I'll say is the return is definitely better than the middle of season 2, and it's almost just like it is season 2. The lady turns in, was it not Norma? Is it Norma with the eye patch? Does it? Yeah. She, Nadine. She
Norma,
turns into,
Nadine.
In like a teenager that has super strength and just like, what are we doing?
Yeah, but that's kind of what happened with the dude with the green hand too. It's like, it's similar. Like, you, where's the superhero campiness coming from?
It's just so odd.
This, like, twisted that, universe.
That's partially what makes him such a fat. Yeah, it's partially what makes it such a fascinating thing. I do think, before I get back into some of the musical aspects, like, it's worth noting that season three, to me, feels, season three and Fire Walk With Me, they feel more Lynch than Lynch Frost, whereas the beginning and also, for better or worse, parts of season two are much more Frost than Lynch. You know, Mark Frost is sort of like, his contributions, they have a tendency to get undersold when we talk about Twin Peaks. I mean, me, you know, because it's easier to focus on Lynch. But I think Frost brings like a different taste of things. And so he's still very present in season three, I think. And I think he has a big influence on it. But I think that season three is definitely when you see Twin Peaks and the overall David Lynch universe more fully merge, you know, if that's a way
and
to
also,
put it. Or Lynch's preoccupations about...
go ahead. I was about to say, because it seems like if you haven't seen Fire Walk With Me, you kind of are missing a ship on The Return. There's so much, like, not even little details, like big parts of the canon of Twin Peaks that unless you've seen Fire Walk With Me, you're just not getting these references. And they're important references.
Yeah, you have no way of knowing that David Bowie is now a giant bell.
Yeah, I would go as far as to say you probably have to watch Fire Walk With Me more than you have to watch season one and two to actually understand season three. Although if you watch it all, it does kind of wrap into
a giant. At the end of the day, it just seems like it's just one big hug.
One big hug. And
it really is.
Yeah.
I think for like Frost, he does a really good job with the books and stuff too after, which is cool because I think he has a good way of like taking the weirdness and the more out there ideas and also just putting those into a narration that makes like a little bit more sense. Like he expands it into like the realistic possibilities of Twin Peaks, you know, and like in all the backstory, I think he does.
Yeah, for sure. Well, plus he loads those books up with like with real esoteric history and stuff. Like they're full of like interesting French.
Right.
He brings a lot of the elements to Twin Peaks that I think are drawn from like theosophy and other more like occult practices. Like I think Frost is the guy who maybe Lynch, obviously a spiritual dude himself, very into his TM practice and all that stuff. But I think that Frost has a tendency, at least judging on what I take away from the books, to sort of root these things in like real life esoteric stuff. So he brings in a lot of elements and I think sort of in a weird way helps set up the... So what I'm going to... So where this leads me from the Roadhouse is to episode 8 of The Return, easily one of the greatest things I've ever seen on TV. When I finished watching that, I was like, how did that happen on TV? I can't believe that what I just saw is what happened.
Gotta like.
But that one has an interesting, yeah, exactly. That one has an interesting thing in terms of the real world versus the Twin Peaks world. So the band is referred to as the Nine Inch Nails in that, which is of course not their name. I kind of like the idea that the Nine Inch Nails is what they are called in the Twin Peaks universe for some reason. But they do this song, She's Gone Away, in that episode 8, obviously, for those who haven't seen it, you should probably turn this podcast off and watch it instead, and then you can come back to the podcast. I don't hesitate to say,
Or you actually won't. I was going to say you actually won't. You should actually do that because I'm going to talk exclusively.
Okay,
about
I'm glad I don't stay in it.
there will be colossal spoilers if you don't watch episode 8 first. So just
So I'm now super nervous that we're going to have overlap, but we'll just see what happens.
Hey man, the more episode 8 talk, the better.
Okay. So 9 So Nine Inch Nails, yeah. They do this song. It's called She's Gone Away. I've never been the world's biggest Nine Inch Nails fan. I do love that song. I do love their vibe in that scene. And it did kick me into a new appreciation for Nine Inch Nails, going in and checking out the records. And there's a lot I love. That one comes from a 2016 EP called Not the Actual Events, which, cue the theme music, by the way, features contributions from drummer Dave Grohl of Nirvana and the Foo Fighters, and also one-time Red Hot Chili Peppers guitarist Dave Navarro. This has been another episode of By the Way.
Thank you. I was waiting for that because I actually, you know, a little spoiler for the rest of this episode, didn't really have a connection to RHCP, so I was hoping somebody here would bring that.
So I do what I can. Yeah. It's important, you know, for continuity. But yeah, to me, that's like, so we go from the Nine Inch Nails thing into this flashback to the, as I would put it, the sort of like beginning point of the Twin Peaks universe, right? Which is the detonation of the atomic bomb in New Mexico. Interesting that Lynch sort of positions the test detonation as the sort of moment where Bob gets out into the world or whatever.
Yeah, it's like
I think it's the human capacity for destruction so realized that it causes a tear in reality and allows immense evil that had been previously kept at bay by, I don't know, the Blue Rose agents all throughout history or whatever. Now that evil's out. We have this incredible, we move into this black and white, basically mini movie, right? I mean, it's like, it feels like you're watching your own, it's like its own movie, that episode. And all this incredible stuff happens. The woodsman shows up. He takes over the radio station, delivers a demonic incantation that basically causes everybody to slip into abject darkness or
this
whatever.
This is the water. And this is the well. Drink full and ascend. The horse is the white of the eyes and dark within. This is the water, and this is the well. Drink full and ascend. The horse is the white of the eyes and dark within.
I love that episode so much. And so I was sort of focusing on that one, and music is tied to Lynch utterly.
This is Wastoids. This is Wastoids. This is Wastoids.
This podcast is sponsored by BetterHelp. Without a healthy mind, being truly happy and at peace is hard. The good news is, therapy works. But what is therapy exactly? Well, it's whatever you need it to be. Maybe you're not feeling motivated right now and would like some tools to help. Maybe you're feeling insecure in relationships or at work or not dealing well with stress. Whatever you need, it's time to stop being ashamed of normal human struggles and start feeling better, because you deserve to be happy. And now you don't have to worry about finding an in-person therapist near you to help. BetterHelp is customized online therapy that offers video, phone, and even live chat sessions with your therapist, so you don't have to see anyone on camera if you don't want to. It's much more affordable than in-person therapy, and you can start communicating with your therapist in under 48 hours. Join the millions of people who are seeing what online therapy is really about. It's always a good time to invest in yourself because you are your greatest asset. As a special offer to Wastoids listeners, you can get 10% off your first month of professional therapy at betterhelp.com/wastoids. That's betterhelp.com/wastoids. Thanks again to BetterHelp for sponsoring this episode. I don't have any good way to fit this anecdote in, so I'm just going to throw it in here in the middle of something else. Towards the end of the show, Agent Cooper and Diane become other people, I think. and they refer to them as Richard and Linda a lot. I've always wondered if that's a reference to Richard and Linda Thompson, the songwriters, because it just seems like a weird combination of names, you know? But who knows?
Yeah.
But in that, we see Laura's mom, Sarah Palmer, walking home with a boy. We don't know that she's Laura Palmer's mom, though, unless you watch the credits, right? Because I don't think they ever say anybody's name. So we see them come home. We know she's listening to the radio. What song is she listening to on the radio? It's a song called My Prayer by the Platters.
When the twilight is gone, and no songbirds are singing, when the twilight is gone, you come into my heart, and here in my heart you will stay while I pray.
Jason,
did you focus on My Prayer by the Platters?
I have so much on My Prayer by the Platters.
We just merged. Richard and Dale have become one. We're all just.
This is like we just can't help
it.
Before we even went into this episode, I was like, hey, we're gonna have crossover, and what are you gonna do? And he's like, I'm just focusing on the Roadhouse. I'm like, cool. I'm just focusing on an episode, and then. What happens? We just end up.
We live inside a dream.
Well, that's perfect, right? Okay. Yeah. But.
Yeah. No, this is cool. Cause I mean, this is going to be a shared thing anyway, because you know, I think I'll probably have a couple little extra things to say about this now because, of how this is panning.
Let's just write into it.
Let's go through.
So that song appears like twice, right? In Twin Peaks. So it's in episode 8.
It does.
When we see sort of the inception of the Twin Peaks universe, or at least where we come in. Because is it the White Lodge, Duwaun, where Senorita Dido and the firemen?
I think that's what it's called. I think there's like a proper name, but I think like for all intents and purposes, one would just say, yeah, White Lodge.
Right. So in Twin Peaks, obviously, for those who don't know what Twin Peaks is, I can't imagine why you'd be 35 minutes into this one and not know everything we're talking about. But there are these two lodges that almost are like sort of nether worlds, basically. And in Twin Peaks season 3, we sort of see more of them. We really only see the Black Lodge in the original Twin Peaks, I think. I don't think we ever quite see. We meet representatives of the other lodge, i.e. the fireman, who's the giant, who appears many times. I think there are other representatives maybe who pop up, but he's the main one. In Twin Peaks The Return, we see he's got a lady, and he lives in a weird castle on a purple sea. And after Bob is unleashed into the world, they sort of create Laura or they do something to bring Laura into existence too.
Have you gotten into any of the theories of, or just the explanation?
No,
of that
you should
scene.
Yeah. Tell me what you've read.
I actually wasn't going to get into this, but the fireman is the giant.
Yeah.
Kind of, right? I mean, it's so, but in the original Twin Peaks, he's just referred to as the giant, right? Or he's not referred to as the fireman. So that I guess is a little confusing for me, and I'm not sure I ever picked up on that. I don't know if you guys know why this person is suddenly two different characters or just has a different name. I'm not
as
really
a twin
sure.
I feel like I can spot twins, and I think that's just his brother.
Okay, that makes sense.
One half of the country brothers, the other half the other twin, of course. Duwaun is not Dom's tulpa, though. He's his own person.
Exactly.
He's not a doppelganger.
There are no doppelgangers in the country brothers. just good old-fashioned twins. So, yeah, I watched this pretty interesting and not even all of it. Like, I have to go back. I have, I think, even on my notes that, like, you know, and I think I mentioned it earlier, there's just so much you can dig into. And once you start digging, it just, it like, it wraps your brain in,
yeah,
it makes you unable to even like formulate a sentence because there's just so much craziness. And like, one of the more interesting things I've seen about that room, about that lodge and the firemen and, you know, it's spelled D-I-D-O as Senorita,
yeah,
Dido or Ditto. And it's, the question is like, is it Dido or is it Ditto? And this theory that I saw was, the guy was like, I think it's Ditto. And I think it's Ditto because there was this thing called, there was a duplicator called a Ditto machine. And so he thinks it was like a film duplicator called a Ditto machine. Or I don't know, something. So he's like, I think it's Ditto, and here's why. So when you're watching this scene, she's sitting on a couch. She's listening to some old-timey music, which I may as well just go into that because that was one of my things. So we'll change the format of this just a little bit. We'll probably just have to just go through this one together. But she's listening to a song that's credited. It's named Slow 30s Room, and it's credited to David Lynch and Dean Hurley. Actually immediately recognized that sound when I heard it, and I got really excited because that's an Optigan, which is essentially like the kids' version of a Mellotron. And so that's just like a twisted, slowed down version of that. But while she's sitting there listening to that, and that's also very important in this theory, like while she's sitting there listening to that, she's sitting in front of this like little, there's like a thing on a stand, like a little grate. And she's listening to a phonograph record playing this music, and there's light coming through. And the way that this guy's described, this is really hard to probably process this over a podcast, so you might want to actually just go find this video. But basically what he thinks is that on the technical version of film and a soundtrack, and how that works is that you have a soundtrack on like the left side of the strip of film, and then you have the pictures on film, and that's duplicated. It has to be duplicated to get the color on it, and then it's duplicated again to get the final print of your film. And the process, I mean, he basically thinks that like the fireman is the director, is the producer, is the one that's getting this out. He's duplicating this stuff through her. She's like looking at it and kind of swaying back and forth through this grate as you're watching her listen to this music on the couch. And then when they go into this, they go into this theater, and you see this beam come down, or this globe come down, and that's like the creation of Laura. And then it goes, and then she sends it up through this tube, and it just like gets printed into the film, the final film, which is the Earth is playing on a screen. So as if you don't even like, as if you're, I don't even know if anyone's even following this at all, but the gist is she is the duplicator. He's made a copy of these things and printed it on the final film, which is just what's playing on the screen is Earth. So it's just go find that. It's crazy. It's like an hour long. The dude really gets into it, but it's nuts. And then the music itself, the Optigan, that's how that works, is the exact same theory. It's a transparent, like loose disc, like very like flimsy disc, and you put it in this thing and you play it, and it spins around, and a light beam shoots up, and it plays the music loop based on what it's like, the flashes of light on the disc. And that's exactly how it's the same technology. So that seems like a very intentional, that's one of those things where it just seems like a regular scene, but you're like, man, the fact that he chose this sample for this time frame for this technology of how film even works, and he has created that in a very visual way with these characters, which somehow ties into the entire thing. Like when you, it's like, oh yeah, that all makes sense now that some total nerd figured that out and made a video, you know, an hour long video on YouTube. It's like, I don't know how that dude came up with that, but that's his theory on that. Sorry. That's my,
no, I mean, I think it's fascinating. Duwaun, when you think of episode 8, I mean, what are your thoughts on sort of the role of music in episode 8?
Yeah, I want to know how you felt. I want to know how you felt after watching that.
Like, what immediate reaction was that was wild. And then I was just kind of like, because like that was, what tripped me out was when I first saw it, you kind of see like the linear storytelling up until the Roadhouse. And then from episode 1 through 7, for the most part, when you see the Roadhouse, that was the end of the episode. So I'm sitting up about to get mad. Like, mm-hmm. That was 10 minutes of show. Is that what everybody was talking about? Episode 8? Because I'm going to be mad. And then, and then you heard that countdown, and you were like, "Holy smokes!" And then I was just ready to, like, as soon as you saw that explosion, I was just like, "I'm ready to go on this journey. Whatever happens, it's gonna be mundane, but it's gonna be like insane, and there's gonna be something happens that's gonna explain stuff." And it gave me all that totally. As far as music goes, I really do like the part with the Platters. I dig that part. Mainly just because of the woodsman. Like the Lynch does really well with like the dichotomy of like showing you like this 40s or 50s aesthetic, but also just like, I mean, I'm not saying anything that nobody's ever said before, but the fact that he can do that over and over again, and it's not even necessarily a trope at this point, because every time he does it, it serves a story, and he's not hanging his hat on that. It made sense within the Twin Peaks universe and the beginnings of the Twin Peaks universe to play that very particular song at that particular time while the Woodsmans was killing people and taking over the radio airwaves, and you know what I mean? Like, and the little monster going in the mouth and all that stuff. It's just really cool. And even like the not necessarily music, but more like the sounds, like at the very end of the episode where the credits come up, and it's just like, it's like that weird electronic type sound that he's kind of known for too, that electricity kind of sound. That was awesome. I was like,
well, because that's another weird thing too, because it's like, not only does every episode normally end with the Roadhouse, but it at least ends with music. And so it's cool that didn't get replaced. It just left you feeling, to me, that entire episode just left me feeling like fully disoriented.
Yeah.
Like I thought, like you were saying, like 7 episodes in, you, even though it's such a disorienting show anyway, like you do, because of the structure, start to feel like somewhat comfortable with like the pacing of it. And then that just like throws everything off, and you're just like, okay, I don't know where we're going now. Like, this just got so,
because
like,
even that happened, that really, weird, you know, part of I want to say episode 3, when we get kind of introduced to the beginnings of Dougie, when he goes through the little deal, the electronic socket, that's like 20 or 30 minutes of like insanity, but you're learning stuff too.
Oh yeah.
And but it still brought you back to like, hey, this is still a TV show, you're still watching The Return, you know. Episode 8 cut all that out, gave you none of that. It's like, this is its own thing.
Yeah,
it was awesome.
Yeah, I think I want to recommend that everybody check out another podcast too. It's called Secret Sound by a guy named Matt Marble. He has an episode on Lynch called The Magic Rustling, which talks not only about his musical side, his own music and the music in his films, but also the non-musical sounds that are integral to his work, you know, from the ominous whooshings to the sound in the trees to various drones, always lots of static, always lots of electrical hum. I think that theory that you brought up, Sam, that you had watched this video about, it speaks something. Lynch is like quintessentially a movie age sort of creative person, right? So there's a lot of social theory and thoughts that when movies were introduced, it changed the way we dream, like as a species, because it introduced a different element of observation and internalization of like scenes and things like that. So I think that Lynch's, you know, we live in a dream, who is the dreamer? All of these questions, they tie one to obviously the sort of like Vedic religious traditions of basically the idea that like we are all a conscious dream of the universe itself or something like that. You could boil it down that way if you wanted to. I'm not super qualified to speak to that religious tradition, but nonetheless, like that's a big part of it. But then when you think about all the things that undergird his films, electricity, the radio, movie houses, screens, like the TV show that's taking place, Invitation to Love, that's taking place in Twin Peaks season 1 and 2, is like another reflection of that. That's another movie inside the movie, inside the movie. You know what I mean? Like he keeps doing that over and over again. So I find that sort of film, the filmic things, I do find those pretty like compelling to like think about those as sort of like skeleton keys to understanding what's happening. But I also think Lynch is very, very resolute that we don't have to understand what's happening. We just need to feel what's happening. And so I do feel like episode 8 is kind of the perfect example of that, because you're just sort of plunged into this thing. You don't know who these characters are. You don't know what this has to do with the story. You're just feeling everything that's happening. You get the sensation of young love when they're Sarah Palmer and the boy are walking home and holding hands. You get the sense of terror when that DJ turns around and the woodsman is in the studio and then crushes his head like a grape. You know, it's like it's such a terrifying episode. But that song, to go back to one more musical moment from season 8, and this is actually not one that I wrote down, but it just popped into my head when we were talking. The song that goes into the atomic bomb is, I think, Henry Penderecki, I believe. And the song is Trinity for the Victims of Hiroshima. So obviously pointing to what will happen with the bomb, the atrocity essentially that happens, where, again, this world-changing capability of destruction is introduced. But Lynch does something really interesting there. Lynch and Hurley, they slow it down, which is a thing that happens over and over again on it as well. Another, they do American Woman slowed down, like 33 and a third, like drop the 45 dropped to the wrong speed. And I feel like that's such a weird thing that he loves to do, like slow sound down, and he likes to slow time down. And so I feel like both of those things are like just such, that's such a cool, weird moment, you know?
Yeah, that's a particular thing that I really love about that entire... He does do that a lot, but he does that a ton. Especially, like, I don't even know what song it is, but there's some... You know, there's lots of, like, dark driving scenes. Pretty typical of Lynch to see, like, road... You know, like, road...
Just barely lit lines. By headlines,
like,
yeah.
There's some, like...
Or headlights.
Yeah, there's one scene... I forget what episode it's in, but there's one scene where it's just, like, this crazy, sludgy... song.
Oh,
like,
yeah, I think
super,
it's
super slowed down. It might even be the beginning of episode.
No, that's
is that when Ray and the doppelganger are driving?
No, I think you're thinking of like the beginning of remember, because that's when we first meet Mr. C, and he goes to that lady's house, and I think that's, he's like,
that's right.
It's that weird like, and they're like really hard like driving like drum sound. Yeah, that's
yeah.
That's
some
ominous
awesome.
Shit right there, Jack.
I love that.
It's over the top ominous, and he uses such weird juxtapositions. When the little person assassin who kills people with a ice pick.
Oh yeah.
It's like, I think the group is called like Blunted Beats is what they're called.
With
and
a Z.
It's like this weird trip hop. Yeah, with a Z. And it's this weird trip hop, you know, that's like kind of like out of fashion, at least in terms of like music that's considered extremely hip. He drops a little of that in Lost Highway and Mulholland Drive as well, actually, at like different parties.
He was like,
not that specific.
He was
song,
like, I'm not going to get the sneaker pimps. I'm going to get these other guys.
Yeah.
Promise it'll be worth it.
I love the idea of David Lynch listening to like a chill out, like lounge CD, like electronic, like lounge Tronica, you know, like, you know,
bar.
He's into that stuff. He's at the Buddha bar. He's a regular at the Buddha bar. But yeah, so to get back to episode 8, to get back to my prayer, the song comes back in the show. It's not included on the soundtracks, by the way. I'm sure it's just a weird licensing thing, but, it comes back in the final episode, during the scene in which it's still Cooper and Diane at this point, but they essentially, I guess it's like they do a sex ritual, essentially, right? Some sort of like magical set. Yeah, I don't know
You're
exactly
right
what
track.
It is, except I know that they do it on purpose, and I know that they know what they're doing somehow. And yeah. Diane covering Coop's face during that scene has always struck me as one of the most like heart-wrenching and upsetting scenes in the whole thing, because you know that these two had some kind of love in the past that was beautiful and pure, but it's been destroyed by evil or something, or perverted, you know?
Yeah.
And so this scene in which this really beautiful yeah. moment could be happening, it's tinged with horror and sadness and agony. And he plays My Prayer. And then they go into another universe, I guess. You know, they become other people.
I have a different take on that one.
And I just want to say on that, well, and there's like, yeah, I'd like
so,
to hear the actually first. Cause
so you said that was Coop and Diane. I don't think that was Coop at that point. I think that was the beginnings of Mr. C. When they drove through and then all that electricity hit, and there's like, oh, they're in the new parallel universe now. I think that's when Mr. C hit the scene. And I think when they were having sex, she figured it out and was just like, oh, no, this isn't the Cooper that I love. This is what we thought it could be, and this isn't the person. And she just feared for her life and was just like, I need to get this over with. I don't think it was something that she was aware of until she knew that wasn't Coop.
Well, because wasn't there more of that too? Like, wasn't there that kind of insinuated when she goes to visit him? When they go to visit, like, don't they talk about how they had like met before?
Yeah.
And she knew it wasn't.
Yeah.
She knew it wasn't him. Yeah. So, I mean, I agree. I think there have been, I think a lot of people were being, because I mean, that doppelganger was out there. I mean, he's been out there for a long time, right? Like, isn't that how that's essentially what happens
of season two
of season two, when he smashes his head in the window, like that's showing that Bob is.
And that's what I was thinking.
That's,
too, yeah.
That's that, right? That's essentially Mr. C.
Well,
yeah. Yeah. So he was out there like for years acting. So I think that Diane had been duped before. And I think that's what makes that last scene so confusing and why there are so many different theories about it, because especially seeing where it goes into, where he's now Richard and it's like, all the stuff on the streets where you're crossing into those parallel universes on that highway, which he like avoids going back into the lodge that one time where he's like holding his mouth with the
garbanzos,
Jason, the cream corn,
Garmin Bozia. Yeah.
Garmin Bozia.
Cream corn,
yeah.
The embodiment of human suffering in David Lynch's mind. Creamed corn is as bad as it gets.
Yes.
It is the worst of all the corns.
Man, and that first Dougie scene. That first Dougie scene, when you first kind of see
that. Oh, that was gross.
When he gets out of this, that's pretty gross. Yeah.
Yes.
But yeah, there's like a whole theory, which again, I have to go back and watch this because I was just getting way too distracted. But on that scene, because I was also making some notes about this Platter song, there, you can go back and sync those two scenes together where, but where that song is playing, and the, there's some really intentional stuff happening there as well. Like the timeline or the physical amount of time is the same in both scenes. It cuts off at the end in the last episode, it stops, but when it comes, but then it comes back. And when it comes back, like it comes back at a different point where the, specifically like what the lyrics are right there, it like starts back up earlier than where it stops. Whereas like before it stops when it's being played in the back in the 50s. So I need to go see what that's all about. But that was one of those things where I started getting into some like Reddit posts and people were like, there was some hot debate going on there. People were like, this doesn't prove anything. And guy was like, yeah,
nerd,
like the bubble, you know, so I have to go back and find all that. But yeah, there's, you can get,
oh, you can?
I mean, I think, yeah, yeah.
The Dune fan
figured it out already. You can get really nerdy about the, about, yeah. It, this gets way nerdy than Dune. I don't know if anyone.
Well, so Duwaun, I appreciate your point, and I don't know that I completely disagree with you. I definitely felt like her covering his face was a reference to an interaction with Mr. C before, and that seemed to me why she was covering his face. That said, when Cooper emerges from the ritual or whatever as Richard, he distinctly has qualities of Mr. C and Dale. He is very much like, so, you know, so there's something weird there for sure. I think it's worth noting at the diner. Yeah. The diner, which is called Judy's, by the way. And we know David Bowie reference. We're not going to talk about, he says Jowday or whatever, but that, I always wondered, did David Lynch literally just start spelling it J-O-W-D-Y because that's what it sounded like David Bowie said with his accent or whatever? I don't know, but
that's another one of the Wizard of Oz things too,
right?
Because of Judy Garland.
Jesus, it's all connected. But he has qualities of Mr. C in the diner when he drops the gun in the deep fryer, which again is actually a really funny scene to me. It's the funniest. I've never seen a gun go into a deep fryer. I love that idea. We should put way more of them in deep fryers. But I think that part of what happens is, and so here's kind of, we can get into sort of the, not the, we're not done, I'm sure, but I'll start to get into sort of my zenith point of my clicks. And Sam, did you make any note about like the song's history or where it came from or anything like that? Yeah. Or the My Platters. Prayer, the song specifically.
I did. Yeah. Cause it's kind of, I mean, we can just both, I mean,
well, so it was written in, it was written in 1939, a songwriter named, George, Boulanger. I figured out how to pronounce that one.
I'm really happy. Yeah, I'm really happy that like you get to pronounce the French. French
he's
title.
Nerdy and
I tried. I want to hear how you say it, and then I'll tell you how I say it.
Oh, the French title of the song. I will not be attempting that. No, I got Boulanger figured out, man. You can't expect that much from me.
Yeah. Well, this is another like theory and kind of, I mean, not even a theory, just a thing that I discovered about this. Like the original title is, which
sure,
I'm going to butcher because I am, you know, don't know how to speak French, but it's like Avant de Mourir.
Beautiful. Okay. Spot on.
Mourir. I watched a video to see how to pronounce that last word, which is spelled Mourir. And
yeah.
It's intense. Like I just, for any French people out there, I tried. Okay. I really gave it a go, but it's difficult. But that translates into in English into
"oh wow"
dying,
oof,
which is kind of creepy, especially if you think of how it was selected for those two scenes in particular, where you know, like
yep,
the woodsman comes in, you know, he kills the girl in the lobby, he starts like, you know, yeah, squishing that dude's brain, not quickly. He's doing it. That's another thing. Is he's like
10 minutes later,
like in the process.
Oh yeah.
As he's delivering this message, which is putting Sarah Palmer in this trance, and you know, getting that bug in her mouth or whatever. But did you have like more detailed stuff on this? I don't want to walk over your
lyrics by Mexican composer Carlos Gomez Berea and Jimmy Kennedy. Probably a situation, my guess, because I didn't get super deep into it. But sometimes lyrics will be written a while after a song, you know, is done, especially in these instances. So I think some of the lyrics came later.
Yeah, because it was written by a violinist. I mean, he was just like a solo violinist or something. So
yeah.
If you go back and hear it, it was, yeah, there were no...
And it's been recorded by so many people. The list of people who have recorded My Prayer, we would, like, literally be better served by just telling you guys who didn't record it. Because it's like every pop
There's a great live version that Dave Matthews did. Of that song. It's beautiful.
Uh-oh. Dave does My Prayer.
I did it.
Wow.
No.
You did? Do you? But do you think you've gone too far, Duwaun?
He gets his $5 from the Dave Matthews Band fan.
He gets now has been approved for a fire dancer tattoo on his arm. You have to show a feat of loyalty. Achievement unlocked. He can now have a DMB fire dancer engraved on his body. It is a really incredible song. There's a Roy Orbison version, and there was a big part of me that thought, well, Dollars to Donuts, that's how David Lynch maybe got familiar with the song. But I don't know, because it is a well-known song. So who knows? He probably heard it as a kid. The Orbison version is really, really good. Obviously, Blue Velvet, Roy Orbison, Lynch, there's always going to be a connection there. But the Platters version, what struck me, because I listened to it 4 or 5 times to get ready for this, it's not a mellow song, you know? It's like really over the top in terms of its presentation.
It's dark.
Yeah.
Like, it's spooky. Like, it's a very... That's what I think is every version. I actually don't think I have heard the Roy Orbison song, and I certainly haven't heard the Dave Matthews version. But
yet.
I do think that it's hard to escape the haunting nature of the song, which is funny because it seems like, I don't know. It seems like the song is possessed by something. Like, there's, when you start digging into the...
It doesn't seem like a pretty song. Like, just the like it doesn't seem like something that you listen to.
No,
sitting next to your favorite person, enjoying their company, you know? Yeah.
It's not pleasant. Yeah, it's not pleasant, but it's like, it draws you in. And I think there's a very intentional reason that this is probably the only song that's been used more than once besides like music, you know?
Right.
There's a reason it's been covered so many times. It's just, it has this like, I think this song has like a soul of its own in some weird way.
I think that's a really interesting way to put it. And I do agree. I think that Lynch is like, I think what we've already talked a little bit about it, but the soap opera, two things strike me about the song. One, we're accustomed to using the term prayer as like sort of like a really, I think we have a pretty, diet grade version of like prayer. You know, prayer is like, say your prayers before you go to bed if you're a little kid or whatever, or, you know, say a prayer for me, I'm gonna go do this thing or whatever. In this song, like, prayer is not just like a thing that's like kind of a willy-nilly thing. It's like the deepest desire of this person to have a connection with this other person. And the singer feels like that is the reason that they should be alive, is to be connected with this other person, you know? So like their prayer, it's not just like it's an expression of like that person's deepest desire, I think. And so I think there's like a kind of like a weird haunting quality of that, where when you look at the most religious literature, you'll find that you don't always have to pray in a nice manner. You know what I mean? Like, sometimes people are begging God for things in their prayers. And that's the sense I get with this. There's a desperation in the song. But I also think there's an over-the-top quality of it. Just that last note, the crescendo, when it hits that, and it's this like ear-piercing bravado sound, to me, that's like quintessential Lynch, right? Because he loves to turn it up to 10 with people. There's a scene where the Veils are playing in the Roadhouse. The song Axolotl, I think, is what it's called. And the one woman just crawls on the floor and then just screams. Do you remember that scene? She just like, we don't know exactly who she is.
Yeah.
Me too, because she's screaming at the horror of existence, and it's so over the top. When we meet the one woman in the car and she's like, we're late, she's sick, and she's like yelling about her kid in the seat, you know, she's
that's
a similar
thing.
She's like, that's your least favorite? Oh, I love that one.
I can't deal with that.
When that kid lurches forward and starts like starts coming out of their mouth, it's so creepy. But I just love the way she's screaming at him like, we're late, we're already late. And it's this thing of like, Lynch loves dialing it all the way up, all the way, way past the point of it. Or when Matthew Lillard is like crying about how they were going to go see the dolphins. Is that, I just want to watch the dolphins swim. Do you remember that part? Like,
mm-hmm.
He pushes.
Yeah. Or how about Truman's wife is one of my favorites.
Oh, just is berating yeah. him as if like absolutely unreal.
And he's just absorbing everything. Yes.
That's a perfect way, because one thing that people knock Lynch for is they'll say like he just doesn't rein people in, or he pushes them to just deliver these really non-realistic performances. And I agree that they are not realistic in a conventional sense, but I do think that what he's doing is, I think that this is, for me at least, like when I think about it, this is the core of Lynch for me, is that human extremity is what he's interested in. He's interested in how good we can be, and he's interested in how bad we can be. He's interested in how happy we could be, and he's interested in how utterly in despair we can be. And I think that that's why he dials things up the way he does, why he plays with exaggeration to the degree that he does. His love scenes, like the one with Big Ed and Norma, they're sappy. They're beautiful. I mean, I say sappy, and I don't mean that as a negative thing. I mean, they are just like, it is so sweet and so moving. And then he'll go from that into the most abject terror. And in a weird way, I feel like you hear that in this song. You know what I mean? Like, there's like a terror to it and a beauty to it. There's an overwhelmingness to it. But that's how you get into the lodges. We know that from Wyndham Earl. It's either great love or great fear that brings you into the lodge. And to me, like, that's what Lynch is after. That's what he's trying to tell us. We can pick great love or we can pick great fear, and either one will deliver us to a new kind of reality, but one of those realities will be really, really scary, and one of them will be, I guess the coffee will be really good in the other one, and the pie or whatever, I don't know. But that's you've heard now, I've just laid out my pet thesis for what Lynch is trying to do with the use of that song. So I'd love to hear what else you had on it, Sam.
I mean, I thought that was such, that's my favorite musical moment.
Yeah.
That song, you know, that's, I immediately went and like added that to my library. I've listened to it 100 times since then, but it does, you know, when you dig into it and you read the lyrics, you read the translation of the original title and like the history of it, you know how haunting it is, how much sense you start to just think, you know, like, oh well, this makes sense, this is just really good placement,
right?
But the crazy thing about it actually is that, as intentional as it seems, it was the song, this version of this song was released in 1956. And it was the number one song when this scene is occurring. So that's why it's being played on the radio. It really, you know, it may not have anything to do with it at all. That's the cool thing about this, is like, you can have all these theories about it, maybe it's just a coincidence, you know, maybe. And the other thing about it is like, I went to look to see like, well, we talked about like like kind of the wholesome like 50s qualities that gets blended in with these terrifying things, And so I went just out of curiosity. I was like, how old is David Lynch? And he was born in 46. So to me, that's some weird stuff too. Like, you start digging into that, it's like, okay, cool. This first scene is like is the year before he was born. This next scene that it flashes back to is essentially how old he was. I mean, you see these two kids that look like they're about 10, you know, they're about 10 years old, which would have been his age at that time. And so you just start to think, like, how much of what happened to David Lynch when he was 10 to leave such a long lasting mark on his creativity, that like all this era keeps coming back. And then he also is just like the origin of all of this stuff comes back around to that exact moment when before we were just seeing like style from that era, you know, and like campiness from that era and cars and, you know, just popular culture type vibes from that time. And now, like, we actually go back, and when we go back, it's the most important episode and the most important scenes that are showing sort of like the origin of all of this stuff. And it, to me, I think it not only like ties the whole big picture of explains a lot, you know, just like Twin Peaks in general, but it also explains a lot, I think, of who David Lynch even is as a person, which I think is crazy. Another little funny note is, like, you may have seen this, but there's a member of the Platters named David Lynch. Did you notice that?
No, I did not. Wow.
Which is just another weird coincidence. So, yeah, you know, I wonder if he knew that, and that's a reason the song stuck out to him. So,
you know, wow.
That, yeah, I mean, I mean, we pretty much covered like everything my entire wall of notes here is on episode 8 completely. So I feel like we got there. I do want to say that there's a cool, also coincidentally, a friend of mine here in New York just sent me an article from Fangoria, which I think it was just from last week. It just came out last week, and it's Trent Reznor talking about his relationship with David Lynch, and then specifically like how this came to be in this episode, how his performance came to be in this episode. And another funny thing to remember is, like, nobody had any other reference point to the Roadhouse prior to this coming out, other than what they saw, like, Julie Cruz doing, you know, like in these old episodes. So a lot of people, and he said this too, like, he originally had submitted some other song, and it was a more mellow song because he just assumed that's what David Lynch wanted. He was like, oh, he probably wants something that's like more like a Julie Cruz vibe or something, so I'll give him this mellow song. And then David Lynch was like, no, I need something like menacing and disturbing. And so he gave him this song, which, yeah, I think ended up on an EP later, he said. But gave him the song. And then also, like, I thought it was cool too, because Trent says that they didn't really know what was going on, but they had ideas even for like the projection that's on them to like, because, you know, Trent is so, I mean, if you know anything about the Nine Inch Nails, you know that their like stage show and production is like kind of a big deal. So I thought it was cool because David Lynch actually let him, they came up with that, and he let them do that portion of the performance. So I thought that was really cool too.
It's clear that he loves Trent Reznor, and that he like views him as like a similar to Bowie, like not just a guest, but like more of a collaborator or whatever.
Yeah, for sure. So yeah, I don't know. I think it's pretty safe to say, at least for me, I don't think that I'll ever see anything like this again. I don't think there's ever been anything on television remotely like this. This is the closest form of like this episode to me, episode 8, is like the closest you can get to like just pure art on TV. You know, it's like I don't know who can hit that more on the nose than that. That's just exactly what it is. This is like, this episode should be in like an art gallery, but instead it was on Showtime. You know, it's like, it's just so. And then in music, my main point with this episode for and wanting to do episode 8, never mind the fact that this is our episode 8 too, which is
there are no coincidences, but, that's what we're learning,
right? Exactly. But also just the music is so important in this episode specifically. Like, there's a lot of cool music with all the Roadhouse performances, and even just some, like, the general soundtrack is cool for this. But I think it's not only super pivotal for the show and the series and the bigger picture, but just the music, you know, just itself is very, very talented.
Yeah. Duwaun, thanks so much for hanging out with us here on Click Vortex. Thank you for being here, and
thanks for having me. It was a really rad talk. You can find me at the Country Brothers Podcast, wherever you get your podcasts. Follow us on Instagram at Country Brothers Pod. We talk about country music. It's me and my brother. We're twins. We're black. We're really cool. And you're going to get a different perspective on country music and Americana and roots music. Thank you.
If you have other ideas about what you want to hear us cover on Click Vortex, if you have some Twin Peaks fan theories to share, call us, 1-877-WASTOIDS. We would love if we were flooded with calls about David Lynch correcting us, you know?
I mean, maybe this just turns into a David
Lynch
podcast now, you know? Lynch Vortex.
Click Peaks. Cool. Sam, we'll talk soon. And thanks again, Duwaun. We'll be back in 2 weeks with another episode of Click Vortex. Thanks for hanging out.